Hi, everyone. Hi, good morning. Good morning and welcome. How are you today? How are you this morning? I'm good. Thank you. I'm excited. Did you sleep well? Ready to start? My name is Sylvia Rigone, and I am the director of the UCLA Design Media Arts Summer Institute. And on behalf of the entire staff, we welcome you to the DMA Summer Institute of 2022. We are thrilled about what lies ahead in the next few weeks. And more than anything, we are so happy to be back in person after a few years of remote summer institutes. So it's so nice to be all together in the same space and see each other's eyes in real life. We are also so excited to host you in our home, which is the UCLA Design Media Art Department, which is more than a place that have walls, computer labs, and fabrication labs, and so forth, is most importantly a community of people that are generally passionate and sometimes a little obsessed about design, art, and media technology. And also who believe that design play a critical role in and affect the life, our life, and the issues that we live in the world today. You're converging here from all over California, the United States, and different corners of the world. And for the next few weeks, you will be a student of one of the most dynamic universities in the world. As a fellow Bruin, you are joining a community that include Nobel Prizes, Pulitzer Prizes, Grammy, and Academy Award winners, and much more. UCLA is the home of many accomplished scientists, researchers, artists, thinkers, and is the place where curiosity, creativity, and far-fetching ideas are valued. Enjoy and be proud to be part of this community. Most importantly, from the undergraduate to the postdoc, UCLA is also the home of some of the best and brilliant students that you can find. So you will get to know some of them today as your instructors and program assistants. And I strongly advise you to take this opportunity to ask them questions, to learn about college life, and also career choices, in particular in design media art. Once upon a time, I was myself a student in this very same department, and it changed my life. So I hope that the next 2 weeks will be something that you will treasure in the future, and that you bring with you as a wonderful memory. We have been working very hard to make sure that these summer institutes will leave a long-lasting impact and will make you grow as an artist. And perhaps you can also make a few friends along the way. That will be great. So the Department of Design Media Art is a very small department, but I have an excellent reputation, right? Experimentations, conceptual thinking, and social awareness are embedded into our curriculum. And during this time with us, you will have the chance to learn some of the foundation core disciplines in your TypeNet video and word classes. Your instructors will guide you through a series of hands-on learning activities, and that will help you build your portfolio for college applications, but also you will gain technical skills and you learn about current discourses in these different fields. So every year, we propose a theme as a way to both inspire you and guide you in your conceptual thinking and loosely tie together all the different projects that you will develop during these four courses. This year, the theme of the Summer Institute is time. So I want to take just a few minutes and spend a few words to try to unpack a little bit the meaning of this year's theme and how it may inspire your work and your experimentation. Time is something that is sometimes referred in design language as the fourth dimension. It is the elements of duration, rhythm, storytelling. It is the sequencing of the before and after, or the delivering of all at once. You can bring order or chaos, depending on your perspective and intention. Every design discipline deals with time in its own different way. Fast or slow, forward or backward, as a designer, you have, as a storyteller, you can modulate time. You can decide how you want to tell your story and how your audience will experience your work. Designing with time is always manipulating the emotional, because the sense of time is linked to our body, right? From the very first beat in our tiny heart when we start the clock of our life to the very last. We may feel calm or anxious, and time seems to change accordingly, right? Our hearts slow down when we feel secure and happy, a bit faster before an exam or when we have to speak in front of people like I'm doing now, or it jumps when we experience fears. On the other hand, though, time seems to be cyclical, and as it unfolds in the rhythm of nature. The alternation of day and night, for example, light and shadows, the change of the seasons, everything seems to come back. So leaves will fall off the tree in fall, and flowers will bloom again in spring. There is an old Italian saying, where I'm from, that goes, everything need to change in order to stay the same. On the other hand, you have the Greek philosopher Heraclitus that say pantare, which means everything flows, which also means nothing will stay the same. So which of these statements do you think is true? Time is one of the most elusive yet fascinating concepts to grasp. The ancient Greeks have two words for it, chronos and kairos. The former refers to the chronological and sequential time, while the latter signify the proper of opportune time for action. So what we can call today the right time. Right? The right time to speak, or the right time to make a choice, or the right time to change course. While chronos is quantitative, kairos is qualitative in nature. But we can perhaps think about kairos also as a conceptual tool to define the special time, like those moments that in our life that stands out, that are embedded in our personal memory, or maybe are in our shared collective memories. So for example, what are those defining moments for you in time? Like what are in our society today, or what are these defining time in this summer or last year, this defining moment that we will remember, the one that stands out? So we need both these concepts, the rhythm and the melody, the duration and the now. And that's the beauty of time, because it can be measured in constant intervals, but it is fluid. We all feel it differently. So and not only that, if we leave our anthropocentric lenses for a moment, think about the difference between the sense of time that a human can have versus a fly, or a centenarian olive tree, or a millenarian rock, the geological time of the planet, or the cosmic time of the universe. How do we make sense of all of this mystery? And what does it mean in relation to our responsibility versus the planet, the other species, the environment, and those who will come after us, right? Looking into the future, what that means for us. How can we switch lens and perspective as we look ahead? Anyway, these are all different connotations that you can think about, that you can associate with this topic of time. And your instructor will guide you to explore and unpack a little bit in their different project that you will be making. And I can't wait to see all the wonderful work that you will be producing this year. So, thank you so much for listening so patiently. And without further ado, I think we can finally get started. You will meet your instructors and program assistant in a little while. In the meantime, I'm leaving the podium to Ellen Tran, the assistant director, that has some information for you and also will explain the rest of the program for today. Remember, we are here for you, and enjoy your classes and getting to know each other. Welcome everyone and have a great time.
Thank you, Sylvia. Hi everyone, my name is Helen. I'm gonna go over some of the program logistics for you all today. And let's see. Okay, so why don't we start with introducing our lovely staff. You met Sylvia, my name is Helen. I'm the assistant director. And for our staff, when I call your name, maybe you can stand up and wave so that they know your faces. Okay, so we'll start with the four instructors, starting with Tang Chow, also known as TC, who is going to be teaching the net class, if you have net class tomorrow morning. And next we have Henrik, who is teaching the worlds class. Next is Graham, teaching video. And last but not least is Ariel, who's teaching print. Okay, and then for our program assistants, these are kind of like the instructor's helpers for the classes. You'll see them as well every day. Starting with Ivana for net, Delaney for worlds, Maxine for video, and Philip for print. So let's give our wonderful staff a round of applause. They've been working really hard preparing for our Summer Institute today, and we also have some staff behind the scenes that you're not going to see as often, but there's Gareth, who's helping with our AV back there. And then we have our photographer, Anton, who you'll see walking around, and we have some staff in the department that you'll meet later on today as well. So lots of people supporting you all throughout the program. But I wanna move on to the schedule now, which you have a printout of in your folders. And I think some people didn't pick up a folder, so if you don't have one, it's up in the front. There's four people, I think, who didn't get a folder. If not, you can grab it later. But we're gonna go over the schedule really quickly. Do you all know which groups you're in? Great, you are checking your email. If you don't know what group you're in, it's also posted on the wall back there in case you need a reminder. But you all are divided into four groups. They're just random groups that you're going to stay in throughout the program. And depending on what group you're in, it will determine your class schedule starting tomorrow. So tomorrow is when we start our classes. So in the first 2 weeks, you're going to have one class in the morning. So for example, you might have print in the morning, and then you might have net in the afternoon for the entire 2 weeks, or entire first week. And then in the second week, you'll start with two new classes. And then you'll do worlds in the morning and video in the afternoon. That's just an example. Okay, so depending on your group, you'll keep an eye out on what your schedule is. For today, we're just going to be around here for the first half of the day. We'll be hearing from our wonderful instructors in the morning half of the day. Then we're gonna have lunch on campus somewhere. You can decide where you wanna have lunch on your own. And then we'll do great group breakout sessions here throughout the building, okay? On Thursday night, we're going to have portfolio night where you're hearing from our program assistants, and that will be here. So anything yellow or anything like group for all 80 of us are going to be held here, down here. And this is called the EDA, Experimental Digital Arts. Any questions about the first week? Okay, so the second week is the same thing. You're switching to two new classes. And then on Thursday evening, we're doing an extended lab night where you'll be up on the fourth floor and you're gonna finish up any final projects that you have. So that will be a later night. And then on Friday is our final exhibition, and that will also be held here, and you can invite your family and friends. It's going to be open to the public, okay? Our classrooms are here on the bottom left. So depending on what class you have for the day, in the morning or in the afternoon, you'll go to that location. So most of the classrooms are in this building on the fourth floor. You can take the elevators. By the way, the restrooms, if you need to go to the restroom today, if you, when you walked, you saw these double doors to your left. If you walk where the lockers are, that's where the restrooms are. There's restrooms on every floor. So if you need to step out for this morning during our presentations, you're welcome to take a break. We do have one classroom that's in Rolf Hall. If you have net tomorrow, and you'll today you're gonna get a little mini tour, and we'll walk you to where Rolf Hall is. Okay, any questions about the schedule? Okay, so attendance is required every day. Remember, you're being graded for being part of the program. You're taking a college class, you're being graded. So attendance is required. If you need to be absent or you're gonna be late or something, you can let me know or your instructor know for the day, okay? The best way to reach us is by email if you're over in the dorms. And if you look at your folders, you have a handout with all of our emails on there where you can see all of the staff names and all of our emails, and that's the best way to reach us. So we're gonna check attendance every morning at 9 a.m. So we're expecting you to be here tomorrow on time for your class, and you can meet right in your classroom. You don't have to meet here. You can go straight to your classroom. If for some reason you need to leave for the night or leave during class, let me know. We should know in advance, okay? You can email me or you can find me and I'll be walking around. But you do need to fill out a form if you need to leave class or if you're not spending the night in the dorms. Okay, so did you all get dinner last night at the dorms? Great, how was it? Good. I heard that UCLA has the best dining halls, so I'm glad that you get to experience it. But you get two meals every day, breakfast and dinner. Did you have breakfast this morning? Awesome, okay, great. Okay, so it's at the dining hall, and then lunch, you are on your own. So you're going to have 1 hour for lunch every day, and you can have lunch on campus. I don't recommend going too far because it's only an hour. So you don't wanna go too far because you wanna get back by 1:30 for class. And so every morning when you come to campus, make sure you bring your lunch money, any medication you might need, a water bottle, because you're not gonna have time to go back to the dorms, okay? So bring everything that you need with you, your backpack, any food, snacks you can bring in the morning. And we recommend that you walk with a friend whenever you're on campus so that you're not getting lost and you have a buddy to walk with you and you're safe. Okay, so try to go in pairs or in a group of three. We will have snack breaks at 2:30 every day. So that will be up on the fourth floor, and your instructors will remind you of that. Okay, and if you're allergic to nuts, just be careful in case any of them have nuts. Okay, if you need to get a Bruin card, how many of you have already gotten one? Just three people, how many of you still want to get one? Okay, some of you do. You don't have to get one, but there are benefits to getting them because it works like a debit card. If your parents want to put money into it, you can purchase lunch on campus. You can use it to go to the gym if you have time to do that on the weekend. You can use it to access the library, get your laundry. And then most importantly, if you want to get tested and do a self-test kit for COVID, you will need a Bruin card. Okay, so the Bruin card location is in Kirchhoff Hall. You have a handout on that that will show you where that is. There's a map in your folder. And it's about a 20-minute walk from here, depending how fast you walk. And they're only open Mondays through Fridays, 9 to 3, I think. But because you're in class, the only time you can go is 1 to 1:30, because otherwise you have class. So that's the only window you can go to get your Bruin card. You can do a walk-in, or you can schedule an appointment, okay? But again, you don't have to do this. This is just if you want a Bruin card. Any questions about the Bruin card? All right. So safety is really important. We all want to make sure you're safe and healthy here. So masking is required whenever you're indoors. If you're outdoors, feel free to take off your masks. If you're eating, you can take off your mask. But in general, you should be wearing your mask at all times when you're indoors. Testing is not required, but it is encouraged. So there's different ways to get tested for COVID on campus. One is the kit distribution and collection bins. Those are in the dorms. That might take a little bit longer, but I think you can just pick it up from there. Did someone already go over this with you, by the way? Am I repeating? No, okay. So you can get testing kits at the dorms, but I think the faster way is to do the last main bullet point here is to do the self-test vending machines. So your instructors will take you on a tour and find you one later. But basically, if you have a Bruin card, it loads money. It loads $2 on there a day, I think. Is it a day or a week? A day, I think. And you can get a self-test, and then it's like a spit test, and then you test, and then you drop it off right next to the vending machine, and then you'll get your results the next day. So we encourage that you do it by the end of the week. Okay? And there's different vending machines throughout campus. These are the nearest ones. The nearest one to this building is Melnitz Hall. It's just out the lawn and then to the left in this outdoor hallway. Okay? And if you do have COVID, you'll have to let us know if you get a positive test. Okay? You can email me or stop me somewhere. And the easiest way to get all this information is to download the UCLA mobile app. That is what the app is called, UCLA Mobile. You can download it on iPhone or Android, and that's what the icon looks like. And it's cool because you can find the testing locations here. You can find which dining locations are open on campus. And then also, I forgot to mention this earlier in my COVID slide, but every morning you're supposed to do a clearance of your symptoms. You're supposed to fill out the survey. Did anyone do that this morning? Awesome. So you should be doing that every day. Okay, I didn't have time to check it today, but you should do it every single morning before you come to campus. And it's just this quick survey, it takes like a minute, assessing your surveys to make sure you're okay to come to campus. You're healthy and you feel good to come to campus. So it's easy to access it if you download the app, UCLA Mobile. Okay, and to fill it out, you will select UCLA student, because I know this might be a little confusing, but you're considered a UCLA student this week and next week. So you'll select UCLA student, then you'll check off your symptoms and say, no, I haven't been feeling sick. And then next, you're going to choose which locations you're going to be on campus. So L is where we are, A is where your dorms are, and K might be where you have lunch, but it depends on where you're gonna have lunch. So I wanted you to visualize this so that you know what to select when you're choosing the locations for your clearance survey. Okay? You're not allowed to enter the class technically unless you've done the clearance survey. So you gotta make sure you do that in the morning. And once you're done, it should say cleared, and then you can show your instructor and then walk through the door. Okay, in case of a fire drill or emergency, there are stairs to the left side of this building where the behind the elevators are. So we should use the stairs to exit and gather at the Sarah sculpture, which is that big black thing outside on the lawn. And if you're walking around campus or you're just exploring after class, and there's an emergency for whatever reason, there are these poles, these blue poles, where you can call an emergency number in case of an emergency. So you can keep an eye out on that if you're walking around in the evening. If you need a ride back to the dorms for whatever reason, or maybe you're exploring Westwood Village at night for dinner, you can call this number here, 310-794-WALK, and then someone can drive you back to your dorms. But it has to be after dusk, to 1 o'clock. And then lastly, if you're not feeling well, you can let me know or your instructor know, and then we'll let you step aside for a moment, okay? I want to remind you, you should have already read this when you registered, but we have a zero tolerance policy here in Summer Institute Design Media Arts. So we do not allow any alcohol, illegal drugs, harassment, intolerance. It's not allowed, and you will be dismissed from the program. So we want to make sure you're on your best behavior and not threatening any property or, you know, in the classrooms, any buildings that you're on. You want to make sure that you're behaving properly throughout the program. Okay, and last but not least, have fun. All right, so that is it for my presentation. I'm gonna hand it over to TC next, right? Thank you. Sorry, I don't know.
Just bear with me a moment while I get my presentation pulled up here. Gareth, when I click on links, is it going to pop out a new tab and then I can navigate back to the main tab?
Probably.
Okay. So I'll just leave it in tab mode. All right, so first off, my name is Graham Akins. I'm going to be your instructor for video, and this is my assistant, Maxine. So you'll be seeing a lot of our faces. And I'll get right into it. Did you have anything you want to say?
I'm Maxine, but you can call me Max.
All right, and my pronouns are he, him, they, them. And do you have?
She, her.
Okay. Cool, I think we're good. Okay, so welcome everyone. I'm very excited to be teaching video again. I did it in 2019, I think, which was the last time it was in person. So I'm excited to be back, and also that it gets to be in person, because as someone that's done courses online and through Zoom, I know how awful it is, or can be. I had some good experiences, but there's so much more that you can't communicate through the Zoom video with just like being in person allows you.
You can chill out if you want.
Everyone can hear me okay? All right, so I know it's early. I'm gonna try to be exciting in this presentation. Some of this stuff dates back to the turn of the century, so I find it really intriguing and interesting. It might seem a little bit dry, but we're gonna get through the origins of video technology. I'll give you a brief overview of cinema as an artistic and entertainment medium. And then I'm gonna wrap up with the current trajectory of cinema and video art, and then show you a little bit of my work at the very end so you kind of know my context, what I'm into, where I'm coming from. The interesting thing with video is that it can be a complex medium to discuss due to its diffuse and various nature as a creative medium, because it ranges from traditional film to more experimental works. So there's going to be a lot of shared vocabulary between kind of the entertainment industry, movie, and then video art, and it's just a really amorphous blur between those things. And I'm not going to give you a value judgment on where I stand within those things. I think there's a lot of room in art to play around interacting with those different aspects, and that's kind of the fun part, is that there's no set course for how you have to communicate with people. All right, my name is Graham Aikens. I already told you that. I've been interested in art since I could draw at a very young age. I grew up in Dallas, Texas. I studied art all through high school, mainly painting, drawing, and sculpture, kind of the traditional things that high schools offer. I got a bachelor's in fine arts and printmaking at Kansas City Art Institute. And then I studied new media art at Pasadena City College for a couple of years, and then just recently finished my MFA at UCLA in 2020. I focus on video, 3D animation, performance, and installation art. And then this is one of my favorite pre-Socratic philosophers, Heraclitus, but has, I think, a pretty profound yet extremely short quote: "No man ever steps into the same river twice, for it is not the same river and he is not the same man." And it's the implications, it feels kind of like a simple thing to say, but the implications are pretty deep when you consider it, especially when you consider these categories we give to things like a river or an ocean or a body of nature. We think of these things as kind of isolated and frozen, but they're actually always in flux. And it's even with our own bodies, like the cells are regenerating every 7 years, and it's like your personal identity changes. But through memory, we have this kind of chain of a continuity, but it's much weirder and more elusive than we kind of think of on a daily basis. So in this class, we're going to be exploring how time and duration can be used creatively. Then the birth of photography, beginning as a scientific tool and later as it developed an artistic language. So here is the very first photo taken by Joseph Niepce. It was taken from his studio and is it's referred to as a heliograph due to it using the sun to develop it, but it's created just a little bit of the chemistry. It's created using bitumen, which is a naturally occurring form of asphalt, as a light-sensitive coating on a lithographic stone. So imagine a giant piece of limestone. You're coating it with a material. This is related to printmaking. So you have a material that's on there. You expose your image onto it, and then based on this process, after you clean the stone, you're left with an area that can be inked and then transferred. So it's not that exciting, and it's really hard to kind of tell what it is, but you can see like the vague outlines of a building structure. And it's much, like in this time, it was much more proof of concept than, it's like you have to invent the technology before you can creatively play with it. So they're really excited that they can make a photographic image, because prior to this, it was illustration and painting, which was great to an extent, but it's completely different than freezing a moment in time with this level of accuracy. Photographic techniques continued to evolve and advance under Louis Daguerre. It was the first complete practical photographic process was announced in 1839, known as the daguerreotype. The chemistry, mechanics, and printing continued to be experimented with and refined. And by 1901, George Eastman of New York created the first Kodak Browning disposable camera, it's basically like what we have today. I guess they're kind of falling out of trend, but if you get, like you go to a drugstore, you get a disposable camera, you shoot the photos, you get them developed. You don't have to do any of that. So it's pretty amazing that in less than 70 years, we went from somebody printing on a chunk of limestone and taking days to expose it to having a portable camera in your pocket, and then magnify that again today. We all have like video cameras and LiDAR scanners in our pockets if you have the new iPhone. All right, so some of the earliest use of photography was as a scientific tool and for understanding motion, because prior to this, horses are running so fast, people used to have a debate whether all its hooves were off the ground at once, and there's no way to actually know because they didn't have the tools available. They imagined, they drew things, they postulated, they made theories, they argued. But with Edward Muybridge, a British experimenter and photographer, you can see on the top right, this is the kind of the stage that he set up. So each of those little stakes in the ground had a string attached to it, and as the jockey and the horse rode across, it would set off a camera for each one of those numbered areas on that building. So they were trying to develop a really precise way to take a moment in time and photograph each micro movement of that. And then below, this is a current technology, but it's transformed into a GIF, and it's a series of still photos, but our brain translates that into animation through what's called the persistence of vision. So this is another early kind of like a novelty, the thaumatrope, where I'm sure you may have seen these as kids, but you spin it around in your fingers and it blends the two images together. Kind of the same idea as a flip book. Just make sure this volume isn't gonna blast you. And then at the same time, they were developing ideas called a zoetrope. This is a modern recreation of the traditional idea. So this is 3D printed, but so it's hard to, I mean, this still feels really cool to me, but it's hard to imagine what kind of revolutionary impact this would have on someone that's never seen an animated image in their life, and they've never seen a screen. Try, like, conceptually to put yourself back in time, and the idea that somebody had this portable means to show you something in motion was pretty magical. And this is an example of how Muybridge would have projected those early images of the horse running. And then this is a newer version of the disc. It's an extremely painstaking process where they took the photos, they had to purposefully distort them in a specific way so that when they put it back onto this disc, it would play it with the correct dimensions. So they would take the photos, somebody would hand paint on a glass disc, and then they would show that projected. And so it's kind of like early video games. Like if you've seen what Pong looks like, it's really difficult sometimes to imagine that this kind of horribly tedious process actually caught on and enough people got interested in it to allow it to evolve into what we currently have. And then continuing kind of the evolution of early cinema, 1893, this was America's first movie studio under the financial backing of Thomas Edison. This is Black Maria. It was a movie production studio located in West Orange, New Jersey. It didn't produce for the big screen yet. That wasn't happening, wasn't technically possible. But they would use these devices called a kinetoscope, which I'll show you, which it was a one-person viewing machine. So only one person got to watch at a time. And this theater has such a distinct look because they needed to be able to rotate the building depending on the time of the day, because their only source of light was the sun. So they had special panels in the roof they could remove so that they could get continuous lighting, as much lighting as possible throughout the day. And as this like sweaty, hot, tar paper covered room, and they're just standing inside filming simple scenes. And then here is the first ever copywritten motion picture, is a random dude sneezing. And then a little bit later, we have exciting things like cats boxing, wearing boxing gloves, which is also really amusing to know, like, both how much and how little meme culture has changed, because I've definitely watched content that's exactly like cats boxing, and this is more than 100 years ago, so it's like there's a deep place in our heart for cute and silly things, little loops. Here's an example of the kinetoscopes. So this is 1894, a public kinetoscope parlor was opened in New York. It's the first commercial motion picture house. For adjusting for inflation, it was about $8 to see half of the films, or $16 to see the entire room of films. And that would be stuff like Fred Ott sneezing, the cats boxing, Annie Oakley doing trick shooting, people dancing. So it's kind of, it's like going to like one of those VR immersion places today. It's like extremely specialized, kind of expensive, exclusive way to find entertainment. And here we have the first projected movie played to a paying audience. So this is 1895. So people are kind of rapidly making technological discoveries that are paving the way for what we think of as theaters and movie projection. But still, all of these early materials are interesting for their technological feats, but it's like these are literally workers leaving the factory of the brothers that made these films. So I think they're kind of struggling to do things technically, and they're not able to focus on creativity yet. But other people are. So the birth of cinema and the cinematic creativity. So in just a brief amount of years, less than 10 years later, we start to see really ingenious creations created through, it's still fairly technically limited, but borrowing from theater and plays and musical, use of props, physical comedy, and photographic effects. Does anyone recognize this at all? A little bit. I feel like it was really big in cartoon references when I was growing up, but maybe it's kind of dying out now. It's a great film. We'll probably watch a little bit of it in the class. And then you have the beginning of the silent era of films, which is when Hollywood first started getting into things. 1911, first Hollywood film studio opened. And in 1914, I don't know if people are aware of Charlie Chaplin, he was similar to Buster Keaton, the kind of two of the biggest names in silent movie comedy. So again, just things start really picking up, the technical evolution, the stories that people are able to tell. They're not just technical demos, these are fully fledged narratives. They're kind of establishing the tropes of storytelling, and there wasn't sound at the time, but they would have bands play music that accompanied it. So you have kind of a multimedia presentation going on. And then 1929, Ziga Vertov's Man with a Movie Camera, films become more experimental and artistic, proving it has potential as a creative medium in its own right. So it's no longer just a documentary medium that's able to capture reality, which was what photography was initially introduced as. Then you have people beginning to use it as a creative medium. And importantly at this time, there was the constructivist revolution had just happened about 10 years ago in Russia. And then the Bauhaus, if people are aware of that, these like titans of abstraction and non-representational art are beginning to exert their influence into film, which is traditionally based in representation. So you have this interesting contrast between being able to accurately capture events, but also this burning desire to abstract and experiment with things, and it creates a really interesting combination of those factors. And then, unfortunately, I don't have enough time to go over, I'm kind of leaping ahead 100 years. During our individual class sessions, we're going to watch videos that kind of highlight the 60s and 70s when video art, experimental video, conceptual art started to have, grab more of a foothold in the art world. So I'm going to fill in these blanks, but this is limited time right now. All right, so 2009, this is just a little bit of context, and then I'm going to throw you in. This is during Web 2.0, when user-generated content is becoming more of a thing. People have a more intimate relationship with the internet. It's not just static web pages and checking your email and chat rooms, but it's like people learning how to code, how to make their own websites.
Cool that you're part quadruplet, and I want you to embrace it.
I was abandoned in a field by my father, my birth father, psychopath, numerologist, self-serving, closet.
You told me.
He murdered my mother for pumping out four, and I'm the square one out?
Dieter, I agree. I was forced to squat a childhood.
Look, I don't know what you're trying to connect. As an individual, my father's situation has his trilogy trip thanks to my forfeit, and I have my independence thanks to his sexy rejection. Don't make me talk about this. The deal is done. It's been decades. The hate is over. Just call it and cancel.
Cedar, I completely admire the way you never victimize yourself.
There's a lot going on in here, and I feel like it's a really fun kind of like a hypersaturated mirror that reflects back to us the Web 2.0 identity flux and on the that version of the internet and kind of the existence that you could lead there. And Trecarton draws us in with exaggerated characters, humorous dialogue. This is Ryan Trecarton, the main artist. And then pummels us with edits, audio, and visuals, creating a narrative in a very idiosyncratic style. So this is actually part of a longer, it's about a 45-minute narrative. It's a very loose and playful approach to a narrative. There is a storyline that goes through it. I find it really difficult to actually watch 45 minutes of this style, but I like just jumping in and finding segments at a time and watching that. It's, like I said, it feels like a mirror that reflects this particular understanding of how individuals are existing in this time and kind of satirizing that in, I think, a fun and I think kind of purposefully obnoxious way. It's, but these artists that I'm showing you, not only are they video artists, oh, sorry, I'm not in my tab. Lost my notes. But I'm showing you these artists because they have a really strong command of the installation. So they're You can show video and photography in a variety of ways. Like right now, we're just projecting it. We don't have anything else going on in the room. But with these artists, it makes sense, based on the style of work that they're doing, to have a more immersive installation that gives you a feeling of being there in the, sorry, if I need my timer. Gareth, do you know how I can get back my timer?
So you might need
I think I escaped out. I might have reset it.
Yeah. Stop. There's nothing. It might actually be behind that one.
Or if someone can give me a time warning.
Let's just redo it and see. Okay. There you go. Okay.
Okay, thanks. All right, sorry about that. We have to keep these at a certain amount of time, and when I accidentally escaped, I lost my timer. Okay, thank you. All right, so like I was saying, these, something to keep in mind as you're doing art here and in the future is the context that you want to show it in and how you want to present it to people, because that's going to have a great effect on the overall level of communication that you have with them. And not every piece requires an installation. It's a very specific style that your intent should dictate whether you feel like that's necessary. But like, it really depends on where you're able to show and the kind of the limitations, but I think I find it more involving when you get to kind of step into the piece and then watch the video instead of it just being a plain video. There are instances, depending on your subject matter, where maybe this really distracts from what you're trying to communicate. If you're going for like a journalistic war documentary, I don't feel like it makes sense to have set pieces that are kind of recreating a fantasy of the material that you're depicting. So it's very contextual. All right, our next artist is Hito Sterl from Berlin.
How not to be seen. Lesson 3. There are 7 ways of becoming a picture. To camouflage. To conceal. To cloak. To mask. To be painted. To disguise. To mimicry. To key. Around 2000, a new standard for resolution targets is introduced. This is a pixel-based resolution chart. It serves to shoot pixels. In 1996, photographic resolution in the area is about 12 meters per pixel. Today it is 1 foot. To become invisible, one has to become smaller or equal to 1 pixel.
And you can see this is a longer video. All of it's pretty fun. And kind of contrasting with the Ryan Trecarton, Hirosh Derel, accomplished writer, theorist, and visual artist, instead of investigating the kind of idiosyncratic individual identity, she's investigating the contemporary individual experience and how that individual works within the broader context of politics, economics, social roles, technology, a large part is technology, and being. And I think it's with a sense of humor and wit. She's often dealing with really serious subjects and the implications of the things that she is handling have a lot of gravity, but she's able to bring a sense of humor to it that I think is kind of beguiling, because, like, for instance, that target, pixel target, that has to do with the accuracy of fighter planes dropping bombs. It's like military target acquisition. And so she's tying that into contemporary thoughts about invisibility within this hyper-connected age of social media and, like, the image economy. And there's interesting parallels being drawn between these things. And the thing that ties them together is technology, because photographic technology, while we're looking at it for artistic purposes, is also heavily entrenched in military technology. And things like facial recognition are fun when you're doing the app on your phone that gives you a new face, or like the rabbit ears from Snapchat. But it's also how drone fighters are acquiring facial targets in theaters of war. So it's pretty surreal to imagine these simple technologies having multiple applications and kind of wide-ranging consequences. And again, I feel like she has a really great skill at creating an immersive environment through installation. And then a sample of some later work, a bit simpler. It's not a video, but they're like morphing flowers, but I find it's a little dark, so it's hard to see, but it's a complex structure that's supporting all of these monitors. And then the final contemporary artist is Jacoby Satterwhite. Thank you. Jacoby Satterwhite explores social media, the body, the self, memory, and dancing as drawing. He describes his practice as a queer arena for performance, and in this piece they're exploring medical technology, the unconscious, sci-fi surrealism. I chose this artist to contrast with the previous two artists because whereas those had a certain level of production value and teams that they're using, this is a solo artist doing, from what I've seen, this piece was completely done by themselves. So they're, I think it's very approachable in ways because we're going to be teaching you tools with a little bit of 3D animation. You could make something like this. The skill hurdle is not that high, technically speaking. Like, there's access to free softwares and simple cameras. He has a green screen and he's making costumes, and then everything else, he's putting that footage in, he's doing 3D drawings that are based off of his mother's drawings, collected drawings. And the other contrast is that this is an almost diaristic exploration of his own subconscious, whereas the other artists are looking outwards to critique things that the mass of people are experiencing. This is an inward journey and using contemporary technology to manifest those thoughts and dreams. This is a more standard kind of like what we have right now, just a large scale projection of a video piece. And then we see a little bit more of an installation. It's a bit more of a cosmetic application. There aren't actually as many sculptural items, but like large scale, but then we see small scale objects on these shelves that are 3D prints of the drawings that are done in virtual reality. All right, and wrapping it up, just a brief overview of my work to give you context of what I've been doing, what I've been interested in. Way back in 2004, these are some of the earliest silk screens I made as a printmaker. My school didn't really have a new media department. They had interdisciplinary studies, which was kind of a rocky department to go into. So I didn't have anybody to demystify things like video editing, 3D animation, 3D modeling. I knew that I loved to draw, so I was like, should I do sculpture or printmaking? I went for printmaking because of drawing. And I enjoyed it, but I felt like it was too steeped in tradition and kind of this romantic idea about previous technologies, which they're still really amazing to use, like to do a copper etching and to use nitric acid and to see the printed ink on the paper. There's something very tactile and enjoyable about it, but I felt like in order to communicate, I wanted to be learning the newest technologies, the newest visual technologies. And this is just, I'm not saying there's a right or wrong, this is just my particular interest. So in after several years of undergrad, I got back into art and I went to Pasadena City College and I took a black and white traditional photography class. And then from there, everything started leading towards new media studies. And this is an example. I learned how to do a process called photogrammetry, which is essentially you have an object and you take a series of photos around that object to capture all sides of it that you can. You plug it into software, it creates a 3D mesh for you. And so instead of modeling it yourself by hand, you're able to just take that photographic data and create a model, which to me was kind of like this magical experience that I feel like was what they felt earlier 100 years ago when they're like photographing things and they have this image they can hold. I had all of these are 3D models, and this was a lot of just me practicing with what the technology can do and how to use it creatively. So again, it's like you're learning it technically, and then once you get that down, you're finding more room for creativity. And then I relied on this process, and it became kind of a key feature of my work and still is. But now it's even wilder. Now you have LiDAR built into the iPhone, so you can scan straight away, or there's technologies that take a single two-dimensional photograph and convert that instantly into a 3D mesh. So again, technology is always changing and you're always adapting. These are some of the earliest works I started making with those 3D scans. So it's still two-dimensional work because I hadn't yet learned how to do video or 3D animation. So I'm using Photoshop 3D, which is terrible, and I don't recommend anybody trying to use, and I think they're about to delete it from Photoshop because it's such a painful, archaic process to use. And then from there, I took a video class, and this is just, I don't have time to show you the whole thing. This is just a little trailer of one of my first major video projects.
Oh my God, you're early. Economy. Oh my God, you're early. Oh my God, you're early. Improvement. Oh my God, you're early. Realization. Oh my God, you're early. Oh my God, you're early. Oh my God, you're early. Economy. Oh my God, you're early. Oh my God, you're early. Improvement. Oh my God, you're.
It just kind of loops because it was just a little Instagram post to share this longer video. So to get started, like I knew how to move a camera in 3D, and then the models at that time, the models I was using were all free models. There's a lot of good resources that I can share with you of places where you get like copyright free 3D models. So I didn't model these things individually, but the way I combined them and then put my own video on top of was how I made it kind of a personal piece of artwork. And then from there, the work evolved to, this is my first year at DMA, so we have to have a solo show and then some later work that evolved from that. So I'm combining the ideas of the 3D scanning, but I'm trying to make it more of an installation, and then I'm using the video work to show what those objects look like in 3D. So it's not only do you have a 2D printout of a 3D object, you have a 3D animation of those objects at the same time moving behind them. So it's kind of, you're like getting alternate views of the same objects. This project, the LA River, was based off of kind of a new form of landscape documentary about things I found in the LA River. And then the sheet metal mower was playing around in my studio, recombining elements to try to make interesting installations. And then I took a pivotal class for me that was about animals on the internet and the way that us as the human animal looks at all the other animals in the world. I'll show you a quick clip from that. So this evolved out of the same process where I'm doing the 3D modeling and then I'm printing out an object that I'm putting in my backyard for the animals to interact with. I'm recording the animals and then I'm putting their footage over the place where I recorded them. So I'm trying to combine these technologies into an interesting way that lets, for me, I was curious about the problem of knowing other minds and knowing animal minds and this kind of desire we have for kinship and friendship with creatures, but there always feels like there's this gap that we have because we're different species, and kind of exploring that. So that continued to evolve into getting out of the backyard, putting it in more specific places with a more direct intent to capture wildlife. And this is for the LA natives, this is at Griffith Park. So again, I've made a physical print and then I've put food on there to have the animals interact with the food, and then recording that footage and placing it back on top. And like playing with ideas of domesticity and wildlife and how wild is what we consider wildlife and kind of the cultural implications of separating things as nature and culture and trying to combine those ideas. And for me, a lot of this process is about physically being in the place and traversing it and doing the recordings. And then the next evolution of the work was kind of a more specific installation for the gallery next door to us. This was for the MFA preview show, where I'm getting further into the theories behind how we separate nature and culture. So I combined three locations, and I'll quickly show you this in motion. So as the title suggests, it's the Angeles National Forest, the LA Zoo, and Bass Pro Shops. So, which I don't, are most people familiar with Bass Pro or like a Cabela's, where it's kind of like a mashup of Las Vegas architecture and wildlife, predominantly geared toward hunting, which is not something I do or am interested in, but I am interested in it as a depiction of nature because it's filled with so much artifice and commercialism about how to interact with, like it's a very specific interaction with animals for the people that typically go to a Bass Pro Shop. Like REI could be the flip side where it's more about a hands-off approach. Bass Pro is very much like literally getting in the guts of the animal. So combining those three different worlds and where they overlap and where the animal and nature kind of sit within those worlds. And then for these, I did scans of the animals at the zoo and the taxidermied animals at the Bass Pro Shop, and then created these large scale kind of chimeras that combine all the different animals and landscapes. And then finally, the last thing, I just have a couple minutes to show you a bit from my thesis piece. So this was right after lockdown. We still had to do our thesis piece, and to get away from everything but still feel safe, I was spending a lot of time at the LA River in this one particular area called the Bowtie, which is an abandoned railroad yard that's completely overgrown. You can see there's still cement left and there's like artifacts from the train yard, but it's mostly pampas grass and trees, and then the water is right here. There's Dodger Stadium behind there. So it's in its own way, it's a small island of wildlife nestled right in the middle of LA next to all of the major city infrastructure. So for this piece, I got into the idea of creating structures physically that the animals could interact on, and then myself taking them out there into the specific scene to be recorded. And then I'm wearing a Zentai suit so that I can key myself out of it. This is a really long piece because sometimes I think it's kind of funny to be boring, but it's also, it gives you, there are times when you don't want to do things in real time and times when you want to make edits. And I felt like for this project, it was important to have the actual time elapsing of me physically moving these things. And so it's me walking through the forest to get to where I'm filming. And then I go back through and I almost completely edit myself out of it. So then I'm trying to create ideas about our presence in nature, how we can never be removed, how we're always impacting nature. There's nowhere on earth that isn't impacted by humanity. So we have this idea that we can be absent, but we're never truly absent. And then for a series of weeks, I set up cameras. This time it's in Griffith Park, which is another interesting, this is a drone scan of the actual park where I'm filming, and then capturing the wildlife at nighttime when they would come out and explore. That's a baby possum. And so I began to develop an interesting relationship with my daily routine of going to the park, checking the cameras, not seeing very much wildlife during the day, and then I would film myself at night, and then I would film the animals, and I would combine the shots together. Because there's like this elusive magic of, it's like I want to interact with the wildlife, but I know that it's their space, and I feel guilty about actually kind of intruding there, so I can do it digitally and kind of create an ideal interaction between us, but we're never actually interacting with each other. I just want to show you this final scene with one more animal, and then I'll be done. And I've lived out here for 12 years, and I've gone to Griffith Park a lot, and I've seen bobcats in person, I think, 5 times ever over that entire time. So there's something, even though I'm not with, obviously, the bobcat in this scene, there's this kind of poetic, it's like, I want to be friends with that bobcat, but I know that's not possible. It's a wild animal. And so it's like examining those desires for kinship outside of humanity. That's my presentation. Hope it got you interested in the history of video, and I look forward to working with y'all. Close my tabs. And you needed it mirrored.
So I will start now. So my name is TC Zhou, and the program assistant for the NET area is Ivana, and she's also here. She's awesome. You should get to know her. So I was born in 1990, so it was almost 32 years ago, and I call myself a media artist. So what does that mean, media artist? Basically, I work with computer, and you can as you can tell probably by my name. So I grew up in a different cultural tradition, and then I'm now currently creating artworks in the West. So my artworks are not mainly exploring the difference between Western culture tradition or another culture tradition, but then it's almost always underpinning my practice. So I've been creating artwork since, let me set a timer. So, okay. So I've been creating artwork since I was very young. So 2003, I was 13 years old. I was still in grade school. I was making flash animation, flash games. So I'll show you one piece from 2003. Little Stars. So, but the background music is Little Stars. So I want to say twinkle, twinkle, little starts. There is a difference between not starting at all and having little starts. I will show you a scene I really like. It's this. So yeah, that was the time of Flash, and it's a kind of vector graphics. So almost how many years later? 20 years later, this is the artwork I create this year. So it's called Queer Leaves. It's a game made with Unity, and it explores the concept of queer temporality. I have a lot of queer studies, I guess, LGBTQ studies. So a lot of my recent works are integration of what I learned in LGBTQ studies and media arts. So this one is actually there, and I will show you. So it's playable in the browser. So the main character, it's a game, the main character is a moth instead of a butterfly, because moth chases the light. It seems that butterfly does not chase light, flame. So there is only one button you press, and then the moth trying to leave something behind and go to pursue something. So, but in its journey, you have to jump through the hoops so you can't get burned. But you might also get lucky and then hit a heart. It almost like feel like in everyday life we sometimes get some good things happen to us, and then we will have 2 seconds of increased productivity. This game is like, it seems that you can stop and then try to avoid the fire, so, but then it's a very hard to play the game. So agency, is it an illusion, or do we really have control over our fate? So this is a recent work I made with Unity, and there is also another program called Houdini. Use the Houdini to generate the 3D models in this game. So I also make games with like, so basically you can tell I'm a game maker.
Okay.
So this game, so I make a lot of programming language based game, and this is made with T5JS. So I write JavaScript code to generate all the interactivity visual forms in the game. And the game is about like liberation. What does it mean when we are liberated? So probably means we have welfare. We have the right to express ourselves, and we have, we can protect ourselves. There also, we feel protected instead of threatened. So, and I'll show you some. So it's also like kind of what it means, what media arts are, right? So I also make, for example, use digital fabrication, basically 3D printers to print this artwork. It's made with machine learning to generate things, and then put them into a sculpture and then print them. So the model looks like this. It's a tree. Yeah. I also made this kind of work. Also, I also have a MFA. I'm also a grad student here at Design Media Arts, so I also have a solo show. This is my solo show. The title of the show is called Symposium, which is a combination of Symposium, Plato's book, and then Zoom, because we were quarantined at the time. So a lot of class were online through Zoom, so it's called Symposium, Natural, Playful, Generative, Gay Loneliness. So yeah, gay loneliness, it's a real thing. I mean, it's also about like what's the nature of loneliness. It's probably rejection, expectation of rejection. But then the way to break off the loneliness, probably it's about building connections. So I also made this kind of work. So it's like continue to explore the combination of computation and nature. So the robots or the thing that's open, so are 3D printed and then they are connected to the branches, to the branch. Another piece of also is made with P5.js is this kind of
hooray.
So
leave me alone.
It's a simulation. So it's about dating, right? So I was thinking about how dating works.
Leave me alone.
So basically, the idea is everyone has a kind of
leave me
it's
alone.
It's almost like OK
leave me alone.
Right? Everyone has a kind of personality score. When you are more similar to each other, it's more likely you will be a good match. If it's like too different, then probably it won't be a good match. So this is the kind of work that I do. So I will quickly give you a tour of net art, the history of net art. And so it will be really quick. It's like it's like 1 minute per slide kind of speed. So the first artist I want to introduce is called Jody. It's actually an art collective made of two people, John Himskirk and Dirk Piesman. And these two artists, so they combine Joe and D become Jody. And then the first piece of their work I want to show is, it's like 9W at the front and then Jody.org. It's probably one of the most famous net art piece. So basically, net artists use the browser to make art. They make art in the browser, and then it's best viewed through the web browser. So when you see this, like you may wonder, what is this all about, this chaos? But then it's actually, so if you look at the source code, it's actually missile, the diagram, missile diagram. But then this is the, you can say it's the back end of the website, because it's very peculiar. This, if you don't put a special character at the end of each line, when it displays, it will just be this continuous random symbols. So, and then, but it looks kind of cool, and it makes people wonder if the computer is actually broken. So, and there is a, so I want to show you a short video, the author explaining this work herself.
Source, and in this source, it's the ASCII scheme, which on it's like a hydrogen missile, and we submitted this to Yahoo, and they said, please learn how to program.
Because the result, I mean, this page is of the result of a mistake, basic mistake of not closing the bracket on the pre-format tag in HTML, which is the first,
Yeah. So you get that was the authors of this work, and I want to show another piece by this collective made in 2009, many years later. That piece was made, the first, this is almost their first piece, it's 1995, and then many years later, they made this piece.
Text edit. About text edit. Preferences. Services. Chinese text converter. Disk utility.
Yeah, it's just a gray screen. What is this about, right? So basically, it's always when you see Jody's work, it's almost like, oh, what is this about? And so this is actually another just purely playful work. It's open a text editor, for example, and then start to read the, as a voice actor to read the new, open recent, close, save, duplicate, rename, move to, refer to. It's a piece like that. They made this kind of work. So I think these artists are very interested in this new technology, new thing called the internet when it first came out in the early 90s. Next, we move on to the next artist, Olia Lialina. So this is also one of very famous pieces of net art. It's called My Boyfriend Come Back from the War. So I'll play through it a little bit. It's very confusing, actually. My boyfriend come back from the war. After dinner, they left us alone. And then you can click. This is basically the kind of thing we will be making, actually. So you can click the images, and then the story continues. Because Olia Lialina has a background in film, so actually he took a lot of aesthetics and ideas from making film into making this piece of net art. So you click this person's face, and then it's characterized by being non-linear. So you have lots of options. So it's like the story does not progress the time is not continuous, and the space is also not continuous. It's like fragmented. So it's kind of hard to make sense of what's going on. So where are you? I can't see you. These are all fragmented things. You don't trust me, I see. And there is a long paragraph. And then you can click this, the left side, or can click the right side. Forgive, don't kill me, him. So it's so fragmented. So what is this story about? So this is what the story is about. Through hypertext, black and white bitmap images, and the frames of web browser, the work tells the story of an awkward reunion between a young woman and her boyfriend. They sit together without making eye contact, and their conversation is at cross purposes. And a fire is alluded to. The trauma of war looms over the encounter. A marriage proposal is made and deferred. So I guess it's hard to talk about. For example, there is an affair, and then to talk about it is kind of difficult. And then maybe you use convoluted language. So I think it's reflected in the form of the artwork. Many years later, also Olia Lialina, that was 1996, and then 2013, she made another piece. Oh, not this one. So this one is actually very fun. So it's like, it's called the most fragile GIF on the World Wide Web, because you know a GIF is made of many frames, and then actually many people, many of her friends are hosting this piece of artwork for her. So like each person is hosting one frame, and then after playing one frame, the website will jump to the next website and play the next frame. So if one of their website breaks down, then the artwork will stop working. So it's called the most fragile GIF on the internet. And this is Olia Lialina. She's not only a net artist, she also calls herself a GIF model. And she explains why she used herself in the artwork.
Long tradition of net art that you work with what you have. And you yourself is the easiest, the cheapest, the most available, the one that shows most understanding. So that's why you can so often see net artists themselves in their own projects. Maybe it could be somebody else. Maybe in my next portrait there will be finally somebody else, but I hope that internet will be still there, or especially that the World Wide Web will be still there. And I
okay. And her own website is also a piece of net art in itself. So it looks like this is her homepage, and then you click home. And it's a huge canvas, right? You can, this is the main stage of her website. There are three columns. And first column is her works. The second column is her writings. The third column is made of her books. So it's also a part of the syllabus. At the end of the syllabus in the resource section, you can take a look. So this is the kind of thing we'll be making, like using web for creative, as canvas for creative expression. And the next artist I want to introduce you to is Alexey Shulgin. He's a Russian artist. So basically he used the most boring part of the web, which are the forms, most bureaucratic part of the web to make something interesting. So for example, you can use this form element to make a horse or make a person. You know, it's almost like you use pancake to make a turtle, make a snake, or use leaves to make a squirrel, make an elephant. So I can show you, give you a demo. So basically, for example, this is made of so many pieces of artwork, so crowded here. So for example, you can click this, and then there's a flag. This is a basketball, a gun, a person, a robot, a bottle, a house, two people, a sun, a car, and a street, a table, two chairs, and a table, a horse. So, and then he also made games out of these elements. It's very hard to reach the end. So basically, you have to somehow click these buttons and you can progress. But if you click the wrong one, you will lose and then you have to start again. I don't know how to reach the end, but that's the idea. I guess you can make games out of these things. Basically, he's writing some JavaScript. So this I will also show you. He's also a performer. He actually made instruments out of computer and played them on streets all over the world. So this is one of his performance. So basically he writes some program in the computer, and then you press some keys on the keyboard, and then it will start to play certain visuals and play certain sound. And that's that Alexey. And then the next artist I want to introduce is Corey Archangel, and then his work is called Data Diary. It's made in 2003. It's very similar to what we will be making, so I want to show this piece. So basically, he hand-drawn some images and put them on the website, and then you can click them. These are called hypermedia. When it's text, it's called hypertext. When it's like picture, you can click, it's called hypermedia. So you click this data diaries, and then you have two choices. One is intro, introduction by Alex, and the other one is watch movies. So basically the idea is, so when we use our computers, it will generate some temporary files. Those files are usually unreadable by human, but then there is also a concept of file extension. You know, we have like Microsoft, we have Word, the extension is DOC, Excel, the extension is XLS, but then the temporary files have extension like TMP, but then he changes the extension to MOV and then tricks the computer to think that that is a movie file and then try to play that file. And this is what it looks like. The computer just tried its best to play the video file. And then he does this for 31 days. Every day he takes the temporary file from the temporary folder and then do it for 31 days. So there is something personal about this piece of work because the file, the temporary file, is the result of that day's use. So even though we cannot decode what's happening in that day's life, but then it's somehow related to the life of that day. The next piece is a very, those are, you can say, are the classics of NetDart. This one is a more recent piece by Cassie McWhorter, and it's called Black Room. It's a combination of net art and game. And there are lots of women characters in there. They are collected from so many video games. It's a very long game. So it's the mood of this piece is melancholy and nostalgia. So basically it's about solving the artist's own insomnia and anxiety. So her mother tells her that if you cannot fall asleep, you just imagine a black room. In the black room, there are black chairs, everything's black, and then so until you fall asleep. So I just want to show you the black room. I hope I can get there. She wants this piece to be a quiet space on the internet. We have like Instagram and Facebook, those news feeds. It can be disturbing and unsettling from time to time. But then she wants this piece to be a more meditative space on the internet. Just keep pressing the right arrow and the character was working. Are we in the black room yet? I think we might be in. Is this the black room? Liminal space, but is there anything? almost there. Okay. Do you see that red character? So let's walk. It's very poetic. Okay, now we are in the black room, right? Yes. So the mechanism of this game is actually very interesting. You play by resizing the window and then hidden things will show up. It's a very strange mechanics. This game has never worked. It leads me all over the place. It only creates other rooms. Yeah, I tried to play it 30 minutes and it was not ending like last night. So you click open, it's a button, right? It's a familiar button on the web. And then it shows you some like nice glittering sky. And then this is the black room, right? A black room with black chair. And then if you mouse over the candle, it will show you some ASCII art. And if you like, okay. So how do we get to the next piece? Okay, right. After I resize the window, it shows up. If you click this fuchsia color, magenta color circle, it will show you to the next room. That's basically the mechanism of the game. Okay, the next piece I want to show is my own work. So I also make net art. Earlier this year I made a piece called Simple Zoom. So it's basically rewrite. There is a famous book called The Symposium by Plato, written a long time ago, thousands of years ago. And then it's basically a conversation between males about the love between men. So, and then it's, so basically I convert that book into this piece of artwork. So there is only one button, you click next, so basically it will throw a dice and then it will decide which one will be the next speaker. And then I basically write a short summary of what they say, think. So the first one is, you wrote to Pausanias, will be the next speaker. My name is Pausanias. I'm in my 50s, I'm a legal expert. Here's what I want to say about love. The love between young men and old men should be about wisdom and the pursuit of excellence. Young men shouldn't approach older men for money or power. The love of the soul is nobler than the love of the body. So basically, it's all of them have different views on love. So it's a dialogue. So it's they don't agree on one definition. So okay, now we move to the next section. So it's about this class. So we will have in the net area we will give at the end of the, so you will be in four groups. Each group will be 20 people. At the end, among the, we will select five projects. So that's like 20 projects in total. We'll get some like small award. So we will get the Magic Lantern Award for best GIF, and then the exclamation mark award for the most surprising project, and then Bodybuilder Award for the most developed concept, Unicorn Award for the most unique art style, Rainbow Award for the most playful project. Okay, then I will show you some exemplary works from past DMA Summer Institute net area students. So the first one I want to show, it looks like a ship, and I think I will give the Bodybuilder Award to this one because he fully developed the concept of a ship. I'll show you. Yeah, by the way, this is also what you will be doing at the end of the class. You will write a short description of your project. You will submit a link to your project, and you will make some screenshot and give your project a title. So this is what the project looks like. So it's a ship. And then this is called, if you look at the URL, it's deck. And then you get inside, you get into the bedroom. And then you can go to the control room. And if you go back, and then you can go to the deck again. There is another room you can reach. Oh, the bow, it's here. You click the start and reach the bow of the ship. So this is a very developed concept because it has, the ship is fully elaborated. And this is another example of a fully developed concept. It's basically a person's bedroom. So this is the living room, and then if you click kitchen, you can go to the kitchen. And then if you click TV room, you can go to the TV room. If you click go outside, you can go outside. If you click bedroom, you can go to the bedroom. Another thing I want to point out is, it's the idea of frame. So it's almost like you create a scene that's like a cinema, and you put another, so this is a P5JS canvas at the place of the screen. So it feels like the whole space has a frame, which is the cinema. So we will also be, you will also think what kind of frame you'll put your whole piece of artwork in. We'll frame it, make it more interesting in a way. And the next one, it's also a very fully developed piece. It's called Murder Dog. This kind of thing is actually not very hard to make. We can, that's what you will learn in this class. So basically, they are just like, you can have different choices, and then they are linked to different pages. So basically, it's like, there is a dog killed. What is killed? A cat was killed, and then we need to find out which dog killed the cat. So basically this dogs need to find out which the murder dog. That's the police dog. So basically there are four candidates, and you need to talk to them. Like, are you the murderer of the cat? And then talk to this dog, talk to this dog, and talk to this dog. And then you will have the choice to pick one as, after you gather information, you pick one as the murder dog. Well, you pick the wrong one, and that's the scene you will get when you pick the wrong one. But actually this dog with glasses is actually the murder dog. Yeah, so I think this is a very fully developed, and it's not very hard to make. Okay, so this one is also fully developed concept a word can give. And this piece, I think it should be called the most unique art style. It's just simply beautiful. This is the scene, I think she drawn this. And you see there is like corn-like thing. If you click, it's also a lantern, yeah. And then you will go to the next scene. If you click the octopus, you will get to the, so there are three scenes in total. I think this is beautiful, so we should give the project the most unique art style award. And this one is also, should be counted as given the most unique art style because it's like using geometry and very colorful. The next project is, I think, it's very surprising. So for example, if you enter this project, it's like you can explore different brains. I think the whole scene is just surprising. So, but I think this is the best part of the project, is this scene. And yeah, so there are many like things I want to show you, but I guess so the original plan was have 45 minutes, but then I will try to cut it a little bit. Yeah, also like this one is like very playful one. So like do not press, but you just keep pressing. This one will probably get the most playful award. And this one is also can get the most playful award, for example. Yeah, if you scroll, you can go to this direction. If you scroll down. Oh, is this one? There's a very tiny one that will give you another page. Which one is it? Is it this one? I think it's this one. Oh, this one, we haven't seen this one. There is a very fun little game here. Oh, hide and seek, okay. So there is a very little one hidden in here, and then not even close, if you mouse over, it will tell you. And then, okay, a little lower, so we go a little lower. You are really close. Where is it? You are really close. So, not even close. Where are you? I cannot find it anymore, but it's something hidden. So, okay, I will briefly talk about, because of the time limit, I will briefly talk about like, so one of the idea I want to introduce is called postmodern design. So basically, postmodern design is basically a opposition to modernism design. It's a different philosophy. And so it manifests in architecture, in literature, and industrial design. So basically, it's if you think about modernism, is you have an ideal of what's good. In postmodernism, is there is no single ideal of what's good. It's so there it can be there are many, many ideals. So, so they don't have the uniform look. So, so for example, like there is house look like a cat. A house look at a basket, a house look at a coin, a house looks like many shells. I think still like even this postmodern philosophy, some are better looking than others, right? So in industrial design, so you can combine like a bottle opener with people, a phone with lips, a table with horse, a lock with snake. So I think in postmodernism, so there is a debate between what's the relationship between the form and function. In modernism, there is a famous saying, form should follow function. In postmodernism, form can be independent from the function, just being played. It adds the emotional appeal to the product. It's just more playful. So, and then in this class, we'll be creating a postmodern timeline. So basically, it's applying the idea of postmodern design to timeline. So for example, you combine a timeline with a letter, combine a timeline with, what's that called? Ketchup. Combine the idea of timeline with a plant, combine the idea of timeline with a game you can go through. So, and the other thing we will be, because like the net art is basically made of text and images, we will not be using images from outside. This time we will be creating our own image, and then I will teach you how to use a software to make pixel art. Pixel art is very easy to make. Even if you don't know how to draw, you can make pixel art. And so pixel art is widely used in video game, and then it's also, for example, used in Macintosh icons. It's also made into a font, and recently it's also made in NFT projects. So the early internet is filled with this kind of GIFs, like under construction, butterfly, and we will also make animated GIFs using the same program. So it's not very hard to make. It can just be two frames. And then if you can make more frame, and you can go 3D. And if you feel like drawing a bit more, you can draw more. Okay, and that's reached the end of my presentation. If you have questions.
Thank you, TC. Thank you, Graham. Great job. We're going to take a 5-minute break, so feel free to stand up, stretch your legs. The restrooms are, if you go out the door, turn left and then go to the left wall. So come back at 11:18. The water fountains are right next to the restrooms as well.
But where I started from was drawing. I mainly drawing, a little bit of painting, as you saw. I got into a school for printmaking, as Graham, and I got really interested in that process and like how the technical and material aspects of printmaking kind of becomes an aesthetic too, like how liner cuts have a, for example, have a really specific look to them. And I've also been involved in experimental electronic music and noise music since my early teens. And sound still a really, sound is still a really important part of my practice. And I think between like making sound and printmaking, those are both art forms that are heavily informed and shaped by their technical processes and the machines you use to produce them and the tools you use and so on. And I think this interest in like systems and technologies was part of the reason I ended up here at DMA. So as I said, I did my undergrad at Konstfack College in Stockholm. This is the work I made in my final year. It's called Microtrauma. And at this time I was doing installation with sculpture, sound, video. I was thinking a lot about like immersion and how the audience or the viewer interacts with my work or position themselves like in relation to my work. So this was sort of I wanted the person to like stand in front of this video projection. It was also between two speakers hanging from the ceiling and like kind of contemplate the video and the sound and the sculptures all in the same, at the same time, and kind of like make, put together the puzzle in their own heads. And in 2020, I made this work in Unity, which is the same program that we will be using for the course. And it's a game engine and a software editor, and a software editor for creating games and apps in. And for this work, I created this kind of mystic 3D world of scanned and like photogrammetry, 3D scanned objects. And I built this hand-built controller, which is Arduino and a gyroscopic sensor. So when you like tilted this skull around, you could look to turn, like look the camera around this scene that I've made. So it was sort of like continuing on the theme of interaction and immersion, but in a more like hands-on way, literally. This I think will not actually play. It's, yeah, right, still pro. I just added this, so it's kind of a bummer, but I held a lecture at the Index Foundation in the first summer course in 2020, where I built a Unity app that I basically used instead of a slideshow. Like I put a bunch of objects in my Unity world and narrated as I walked around that world. And maybe I'll show you this in class later on, because it's not, yeah, you see, not processed yet. I was continuing to work with Unity anyway. This is my graduation show for my undergrad. It's called Dunia. It's audiovisual installation with some sculptures in it. And this was made in Unity, but it was not interactable by the audience, but it was sort of a self-playing game where these like characters kind of moved around this 3D world and different things happened. And it also had this component, another kind of stream where these little like dots, squares moved around and interacted with each other, like based on their kind of demeanor and their traits and personality, and all this log like kind of talked about what was happening. So again, more like work with Unity. This work was inspired by connections between computer technology and the supernatural. There's like something called the pandemonium architecture, which was a model for early AI where the different nodes were called demons for whatever reason. And the game scholar Espen Arset, who's very important for game studies, talks about cybertexts, which is what he calls video games, computer games, but he also, in his like analysis, the tarot and the I Ching and like different methods for divination or fortune telling are also cybertexts. We can get into that if you want to talk to me more about it, but it's a little involved to talk about now. So one part of the preparation for this work was sort of creating like a bestiary or a character document where I wrote about these characters and like what, who they are and what their demeanor and their relations and their kind of personalities. So I would say this is kind of tying into world building, as we will talk a little bit more about. This was my solo show here at DMA. I was kind of also continuing on the same theme with like characters in a 3D environment or a virtual environment kind of interacting. I had this generated, kind of semi-randomly generated text chat between these characters. But maybe that's like, maybe this is where it all started, really, with world building. Like, in my early teens, I was heavily into role-playing games and like tabletop, Warhammer and stuff. So this is a terrain piece I made for the Warhammer 40,000 tabletop game, which is like, the design of this piece was like tying into the world building of the game. Like, it's this kind of dystopian, like bombed out, war-torn future environment. On the right, there's some sort of comic or draft of a comic or something that I probably did in the mid to late 90s. You can tell, like, from the subject matter that I was already, like, kind of involved with sci-fi fictional worlds. So I think world building's been something I've been interested in all my life, in some way or the other, and it's still pretty important in my artistic practice, I would say. So what is world building? Telling a story and or inventing a world. Wikipedia definition is: world building is the process of constructing a world, originally an imaginary one, sometimes associated with a fictional universe. World building is a broad term. It can refer to a lot of different ways of creating a world, from highly structured to more improvised and organic. This is a model for world building by Leah Zaidi, which divides the world into 7 foundational topics that have implications on a scale from individual to civilizational. And this can be used as sort of a template or a checklist to think about how a world works. So, you know, we have the economics on an individual scale and on a societal scale and so on. We often talk about bottom-up or top-down world building, where bottom-up world building starts from small details, like a character or a city, and then expands kind of as the story progresses. And top-down world building starts by developing a large-scale concept of the world, like maybe the global geography and the nations, and gradually adds more and more detail. There's like DC and Marvel universes have grown from bottom up, because there have been many contributions over the years, many different people and writers, and they weren't really structured to us, super structured according to a predetermined plan. By contrast, J.R.R. Tolkien, who wrote Lord of the Rings, created languages and history and like everything before he even wrote the novels. And a lot of, especially fantasy writers, use kind of this same process. This kind of top-down world building requires a lot of effort and work. It's like kind of a lot of time. Some of it might not even make it into the story you want to create. Bottom-up world building is easier and doesn't take as much time, but being less structured, you can run into problems like inconsistencies, logical errors, and continuity errors. The DC universe, which Superman is a part of, has famously solved this by inventing a multiverse where multiple versions of the same character kind of exist in parallel universe. So if there's an inconsistency, you can be like, oh, like that was actually Superman from that other universe where that other thing happened. So I think it's worth talking about world building versus storytelling, because it's kind of hard to see where one ends and the other begins sometimes. Especially if you're talking about this kind of bottom-up world building, where you're sort of writing a story and adding more and more, you know, detail of the world as it progresses. I would say, like, in short, the more you need to invent or explain of the world your story is set in, the more you're engaging in world building. J.R.R. Tolkien wrote this essay called On Fairy Stories, with this quote, like, very little about trees as trees can be got into a play comes from. And he's talking in this essay about literature versus drama, and drama as in like theater plays. And according to Tolkien, drama prioritizes characters, even the basest and dullest, to things. So this could be seen as a comparison between world building and storytelling. Like, are you just talking about the characters and their relations, or are you also talking about things? And Lord of the Rings is certainly a story where things are important, right? It's about a thing. So we're going to look at some examples of stories and see to what extent, to what degree they engage in world building. So I chose Euphoria. It's a story that's fictional, obviously, but it could be our world. Like, these characters don't exist, but they could exist. They're like, the world they live in is more or less identical to ours. We can take for granted that the viewers understand this world, like we don't have to really explain anything. No world building necessary, essentially. Stranger Things could be our world, but it isn't. It's very similar, but it also involves fictional elements that clearly don't exist in our world. And we don't have to explain the entire world. Like, it's in America in the 80s, that's all a lot of things we can take for granted that the viewer understands, but some of the concepts, like the supernatural powers or the monsters or the government agencies or whatever, need to be built and explained and kind of communicated to the viewer, because otherwise it won't make any sense. And Game of Thrones, like a classical kind of high fantasy story, definitely not, decidedly not our world, not like historic, not like now contemporary history. It's like medieval Europe, but there's also dragons and magic, and it's not like actually Europe, there's other nations, other cultures and so on. It's completely different to ours. The story involves constructing more or less a whole global fictional world. So that's sort of like high level world building. And even if we're more interested in the story than like constructing a world, most stories still contain some sort of spoken or unspoken rules, like we call it canon or lore or continuity or whatever context, that like what's believable, what makes sense, what doesn't. And when a story lacks this, it's not usually not very interesting. It's kind of hard to follow. It's like when a little kid tells a story, it's just like anything can happen. It's kind of just a trope of storytelling, and we can also obviously go against this canon or context. We can subvert it and create unexpected or dramatic effects, but we're still relating to it somehow. Like, if Superman wasn't canonically good, it wouldn't be dramatic when Superman turns evil. And speaking a little more about superheroes, I want to kind of get a little heady. In the book Super Gods, the comic writer Grant Morrison talks about superhero comic worlds like Marvel or DC as actual parallel universes. He says, could they actually have a kind of elementary awareness, a set of programs that define the rules and maintain their basic shapes while allowing for development, complexity, and potentially some kind of rudimentary consciousness? So he's essentially implying that fictional comic book universes are conscious. And in context, it means that these worlds have a long and complex history. They have societal structures and inhabitants and even laws of physics that have been generated over a really long time by input from different people writing and drawing comics. He notes that a lot of writers, fiction writers of different genres, not just comics, talk about how sometimes in a story, a character wants something, the character can change the story from what the writer expected it to be, because when they got deep into writing it. And he compares this to emergence, which is the concept of an entity or system gaining features that don't exist in any of its parts, like what happens in evolution. So he arguments that so much information and complexity have been added to these systems, these fictional worlds, that they've actually developed a sort of autonomous state. And yeah, it's pretty heady. And Morrison probably means this, he actually probably means this literally, because he's kind of a weirdo. And he does magic and stuff, but we don't have to agree that these fictional universes are actually self-aware, obviously, but we can also see that they aren't just random either. They're highly structured and they're governed by internal laws, and they have continuity. They've grown out of decades and decades of stories and input. And fans and readers of these comics kind of instinctively know the rules and parameters of these worlds and will reject stories that go against them, in, essentially. In this way, there's like a mutual relationship between the author and the reader too, because the author can only really go on creating stories in this world as long as people are invested in it and will buy it and be interested and believe in it.
Right, so why we do world building and a little bit about utopia, dystopia, and deconstruction. This is the painting Etin Arcadia Ego by Nicolas Poussin from 1638, and it's kind of an allegory on utopia. We'll talk more about it afterwards if anyone is interested. Another quote from Grant Morrison, what we construct in our imaginations, we have a knack of building or discovering. One purpose of world building, like all creativity basically, is that it can be, serve as an inspiration or guide for future developments. The comic artist or cartoonist Jack Kirby made up this thing he called the Mother Box, which is like essentially a handheld supercomputer, and a lot of people have made a kind of obvious connection to the smartphone. But fiction and world building can inspire other things than technology as well. A utopia, so you might have heard about these concepts before, but a utopia is an imaginary community or society that possesses highly desirable or nearly perfect qualities for all its members, is according to Wikipedia. The word comes from this novel by Sir Thomas More from 1516. It's a fictional story of an ideal, kind of ideal kingdom, his ideal society. Utopias are kind of like not so common in fiction because most fictional stories are kind of based on some sort of conflict or problem or, you know, something that needs to be resolved, and a true utopia would not have any problems at all. Some stories can still have elements of utopianism in them, like the process of creating a utopia or a utopia that is threatened or in conflict with other societies, for example. Star Trek, the original Star Trek series, deliberately utopian in its like portrayal of a future for humanity where humans and aliens of all races are united in this Starfleet, United Federation of Planets, and where they're like governed by humanitarian values and progressive values, and they will run into like dangerous situations or conflicts sometimes, but they will use these like progressive humanitarian values to solve the problems they encounter. By dystopia, by contrast, is a speculated community or society that's undesirable or frightening. I would guess that dystopias are a little bit more common in fiction because they're more like create more opportunity for conflict and drama. Dystopias often serve as allegory, which is another term. Wikipedia defines an allegory as a narrative or visual representation in which a character, place, or event can be interpreted to represent a hidden meaning with moral or political significance. So 1984 is a pretty well-known example. The Handmaid's Tale too. So dystopias can serve to warn us against what could happen to our world if we don't watch out, if we're not politically or morally righteous. Utopia is perfect and good, but is it really? Like, who's utopia? Most of the Star Trek franchise series center around the Starfleet, which is like the armed wing of the United Federation of Planets. And in the series, they're like depicted as a humanitarian and progressive organization with racially and culturally diverse crews and so on. But I mean, I would argue that most military empires believe themselves to be benevolent and good, and like not a lot of people actually see themselves as evil. They just kind of define good differently. The US military certainly dubs itself as a peacekeeping force, but you know, a lot of people criticize the US military for different reasons. So oftentimes perfect societies or utopias are envisioned as stable and peaceful, but this like stability could also mean oppression, control, like silencing of dissidents and marginalized groups and so on. So it's just something to think about. By contrast, dystopias are obviously negative futures, negative visions of the society, but sometimes, you know, they're kind of cool. Like most people would say cyberpunk is a dystopic genre, but a big part of the appeal of cyberpunk is excitement, like visual pleasure, adventure, coolness. We might not want to live in that world, but like 1984, by contrast, is kind of just a horrifying society, but cyberpunk is, you know, kind of exciting. And the hero in cyberpunk stories is often like a rebel or a hacker or kind of an outlaw. So maybe what we find in these stories are like role models for about to how to resist the dystopia, like how to rebel against it. Maybe not. Maybe we just forget about the warning message and we just get kind of get seduced by all these cool neon lights and cars and guns and stuff. Some people would disagree with like some of the claims of cyberpunk that technology and cyborgs and such is dystopian, and claim that like breaking up of boundaries between human and machine can be a source of inspiration for like women and queer liberation. And Donna Haraway has a world famous book called The Cyborg Manifesto, which is like a very well-known example of this kind of thinking. Naomi Wu is a Chinese engineer, like DIY maker, and kind of an internet celebrity who advocates for hacker ethos, like open source technology, gender equality, like more marginalized people in STEM, and so on. And she has this persona that she calls the sexy cyborg, which kind of plays with gender stereotypes and like stereotypes about smart women and women in STEM, and also like notions of humans and cyborgs, like human and machine. And she's obviously like visually inspired by cyberpunk aesthetics, but her ambitions are like benevolent or utopian. That's also something to think about. World building can also be applied to kind of our world, kind of reverse engineering our world. This is Leah Zaidi, who created the Seven Foundations model that I showed earlier. And she works with world building as like a strategic and analytical tool. And in 2022, she took part in Project Unsung, which was initiated by the UN Human Rights Council, and applied world building to look at how the narrative around refugees and the refugee crisis was constructed and how it might be changed. So world building is really done in the real world all the time, with like framing of political events to suit different perspectives. We might consider using the tools of world building as an inspiration to kind of start picking apart these stories as well, and also to construct alternative ones. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the course. And this course will be centered around building a navigable world in Unity 3D, which is a platform for creating computer games and interactive apps, as I kind of talked about earlier. We will be learning the workflow of designing games in Unity, but we're doing it in a context of world building. So rather than designing a game, I want you to design a world, and we'll then make like an sort of a game which in which you can like visit and walk around in the world you've designed. Walking simulator is a term for a genre of adventure games that have been like rising in the last 10 years or so that don't really have a lot of like gameplay elements. There are usually no enemies or, you know, guns or points or things. It's sort of games where you explore an environment and experience a story by doing so. And what we will like end up with at the end of the course, or what you will end up with, is sort of like a walking simulator. So if you want some inspiration, you can Google walking simulators. You'll find a lot on the subject. It's also sort of a contested term. Like some people, I think it was originally like walking simulator was originally sort of an insult to these games, or like a diss on them. But I think it's just been reclaimed now. Like it's just kind of what it's called. And since it's a very brief course, you won't really have time to make a full world like all the way from scratch, especially like since world building requires you to design a whole world, like not only characters and swords or whatever, but like all these menial background things like houses and trees and so. For the purpose of like having time to do something, we have this land bashing kit, which I'll
show you all how to import into Unity in your first class. And it's a ready-made collection of 3D assets that you can assemble together into your creating your worlds. And we'll also be talking about kit bashing. This is my skull wolf that I made. And it's kit bashing is it's kind of a term for taking pre-made model parts and combining them in unexpected ways to create something new. So an overview of the schedule. Day one, we'll be talking about world building in Unity. Each class will be roughly 2 hours of like me instructing and you following along. Like I'll be doing demos and you'll be expected to like follow my lead kind of. And we'll have some breaks, of course. And then we have 1 hour of studio time where me and Delaney will assist you with your projects. The first day will probably be a little more instruction, a little less studio time because you haven't really gotten started yet. And I have some kind of a lot of things I want to get through that day. But first day intro, we'll familiarize you with the Unity editor. We'll get that land bashing kit package imported. And you will kind of create a terrain and place something. Create a terrain, place something in it, and place a little controller in it so you can start looking around. And you should also start working on a concept for your world. Day two will be, yeah, I don't know if I should go through all this because we'll talk about it in the course, but yeah, we'll get a little deeper into materials, colliders, some triggers. You should, by day two, you should be working on like your final world. You should be on the way to like your final project. Definitely. Day three, sound, lighting, and post-production. Day four will be a wrap-up day where we'll have studio time all day, and then at the end we'll show our projects to the class. And deliverables are a Unity app, like as I talked about, a navigable 3D world that we will publish, and we're gonna figure out if we'll be presenting this on the web, we'll be presenting this at the exhibition here in the EDA, but also on the website, and we may be able to create like a playable version online that we can, like a WebGL version that we can upload to the website, but we're not really sure yet. It has some technical issues we need to resolve, so if we can't do that, we'll make a little video of it and put it out on the website instead. And I also want you to do a written concept document for your world, including setting, history, context, narrative, mood. And remember, time is the theme for this year, so history and that kind of like temporal setting is important. And how you plan to express this concept with stylistic choices, visual and audio, level design, and sequencing of the level. It's a pretty short thing, but I just want you to like think about this and conceptualize it and not just kind of wing it, you know. I want you to have a plan that you follow. And start thinking about this as soon as possible. It'll be easier for you to get started if you have like a clear idea. And I'll also give you some like guidance and tools on how to kind of create this document. And yeah, that's it. Feel free to reach out if you have any questions. And I'll see you tomorrow. Some of you, I mean.
Hi, my name is Ariel. I'm the instructor for print. Our TA will be Philip Otto. This is a brief overview of the presentation, like Henrik did. First of all, we'll talk a little bit about Philip and myself. I'll discuss a little bit of my artistic practice, specifically as it relates to print. We'll talk a little bit about the contents of the class, what are the things that we'll be learning. We'll talk about the projects that we'll be doing, and we'll also talk a little bit about context. So we'll try to discuss some of the artists that we can think about when talking about print and how these examples can make us learn a little bit in a deeper way and help us illustrate some concepts. We'll also go over a lot of examples during the class. This will be brief. And we also have a little bit less time than we did initially, so we'll try to go quickly. So again, we'll start by talking a little bit about Philip and myself. So Philip, you wanna come up?
Hi everyone, thank you. It's really exciting to see everyone in person. So I'll go over a bit more of my work, both in class and also at portfolio night. But as Sylvia mentioned earlier, we're really all here because of you. And I wanted to just give a little bit of background about myself so that you can have a little bit of an understanding of where I come to this from. And so I was born at home in Laurel Canyon. My parents didn't believe in hospitals or Western medicine, and they also didn't value traditional education. So my first time in a classroom was when I took driver's ed when I was 16. And it wasn't until I was 20 that I started taking classes at community college. So instead of going to school, I grew up working in my family's juice business. And after deciding for myself that I wanted to pursue my education, I started taking classes at Santa Monica College. And after many years of general education classes, I started taking classes in the art and design department. And I really loved it. It really felt like I had found my passion and something that I really wanted to pursue. And in 2009, I transferred to UCLA's Design Media Arts program, where I just graduated this spring, becoming after my brother, the only person in my family to get a bachelor's degree. And my diverse background has resulted in acquiring a myriad of skills that I continue to work on and refine as I work on creative freelance and home projects. I apprenticed with a plumber where I worked on copper repipes, learning to solder and other plumbing skills. I worked with a general contractor doing construction and rewired the electrical in my family's home, working alongside a friend of mine that is an electrician. I co-founded a landscape design firm where I designed and installed landscape architecture, outdoor furniture, irrigation systems, and lighting schemes. I led trail building and habitat restoration events for volunteers with the California State Parks Foundation. I also worked as the in-house graphic designer for the Theodore Payne Foundation, designing websites and pamphlets about the importance of diversity and to help Angelenos understand the complex interconnected relationships that exists in our ecosystems in Greater Los Angeles. Last year, I was a teaching assistant for the Design Media Arts Summer Institute, also again for the print class. And I loved the experience. I really love teaching and typography and print. And I'm so excited to be here in person and to see all of you here. And I really look forward to working with each and every one of you and seeing what we all produce together over the next 2 weeks. So thank you again for joining us.
Thanks, Philip. As you can
can see both Philip and I have some kind of trouble with our pictorial representations. As I said, my name is Ariel. I was born in the northern region of Patagonia in the south of Argentina. I graduated from a technical high school. We have technical high schools in Argentina where you learn a trade. So I'm an electronics technician. From there, I moved over to undergrad. I studied studio arts for a year, and I got kind of bored. And then I found out about the field of media arts, and I switched over to an undergrad program that's kind of similar to the program we have here, so a program that is geared towards multidisciplinary design practices. I graduated in 2015 from the National University of La Plata in Argentina. In 2019, I attended the School for Poetic Computation in New York, which is a mixture between a school and a residency program. And that was really a great experience. And after being there, I decided to attempt to attend graduate school. So I applied to a number of graduate programs, and luckily I got admitted here, and now I'm here. I'm a grad student at DMA with Hendrik and TC. I'm interested in a multidisciplinary and collaborative approach to art. And what this means is that I like to move between mediums. I don't really like specificity for myself or being specialized. I get really bored very quickly. And I really like to work with people because I tend to do many different things. I tend to not be great at them, right? Because it's very difficult to be very good at many things. So I tend to work with people, and I appreciate being able to work with people who are better than me at certain things. My general interests, I would say, are education, access to arts and culture, the history of labor and labor movements, the concept of emotional labor, social justice, death, memory, and community, and these are the things that I think and worry about. So I'll try to be quick with this. Before coming here, I worked as a teacher full-time for about 5 years in different institutions. One of the schools that I taught at was a really small public art school run by the city council back home. It's a free school where you go and you take classes. It doesn't have a formal model of education. You just go and you take a class and you learn how to play guitar, or you take a class and you learn how to make video games. And I taught a range of classes and for a really wide range of ages. I had 8-year-old students, and we had an 84-year-old student at one point. And I taught classes on like video games for kids, creative coding, introductory media art practice. But I also had the chance of working with a printmaking professor who was great. She studied in Mexico, and she taught me a lot. I had a little bit of knowledge of printmaking before. And this is just some clips from one of our classes where we were really trying to, we didn't have a lot of resources. This job was like a place where I constantly fought for more resources and materials and equipment that we didn't have. So this was us trying to make large format woodcuts without the proper equipment. So we just printed with a car, and it worked. So I've selected a little bit of my work that has to do with print. I don't specifically work with print all the time, but having this experience of teaching printmaking and studying a little bit of printmaking at university, and then also having this experience as working in digital environments has led me to make some experiments. So I'm just going to share a couple of things that are more like little experiments than fully fledged out works. So this is a screenshot from, a scan of a few pages of a beautiful book that is the first technical description of computer halftones. So these are the first methods for displaying tones that are intermediate between like fully black and fully white in computer screens. This is from the MoMA library in New York, and I was fascinated by the fact that in order to be able to explain this, the author made these like woodcut drawings of pixels that don't really exist, but it was like the way to conceptualize this idea of like making gray things. It's like assimilated to like a halftone print. So I made some experiments with this. I'm very interested in fabrication. I was lucky to have access to a fabrication facility back home. So this is that same idea. So these same little tiles, but applied to a larger image and laser cut, laser engraved, and then inked and printed. So trying to go through this process of computer halftone digitally, but then turning it into physical inked print. I'm interested, printmaking is interesting to me. I'm interested in the labor it takes, the amount of work. I'm interested in the technical knowledge, and I'm also interested in the uniqueness of each print, right? So it's like this digital process that still yields like unique designs because there's all this analog physical material that goes into it. This is the same, this was done when my father almost died of a heart attack, so I was thinking a lot about hearts last in 2020, I think. And I made these little animation loops, also through like laser etching of an acrylic plate and then printing it. So this is similar to what we call a dry point etching in printmaking, but done through laser. And these are like different frames of an animation. If you look at the image on the right, I don't know if you can tell, but they're different. And they produce this kind of thing. And they're really small also. They're like about a centimeter or I guess half an inch in size each one. So I was like trying to find the limits of resolution of this like analog printing technique and how we could work with it through animation. Yeah, so these are just some experiments, right? And they're I think Graham made a comment about this, about needing to understand technicality before being able to be creative. So this is just me trying to understand how these technical processes that I'm not very good at work. And I tend to learn with my hands. So I like doing things in order to understand them. I like having things in my hands. This is another example. This was done during the pandemic as well. As I said, I have a little bit of training in electronics, so I've always worked with like hardware design and PCB design. PCBs are printed circuit boards, so the circuit boards that we all have in our devices, right? And I've always been very frustrated by this because it's incredibly boring and difficult and technical. So I was trying to find a way to make electronics pieces that would also work as graphic pieces that would be visually interesting and that would convey some form of visual emotion without just being this like square of copper that does a thing. So the one on the right is my first test. So that was like a hand carved circuit, and it's just like a little wolf that has lights in its eyes. But then I made the other ones that are a little bit more complex. These are just some detail shots. This was like really trying to hand make these like printed things that are like technically complex devices, but I was still interested in making them with my hands and really understanding them and really like morph this matter. And yeah, so these are done through a print process. It's not really, I guess it is, you like print them on toner paper and you transfer it with heat, so like just with a clothes iron onto this PCB material, and then you etch it with an acid solution that's super toxic and you shouldn't be doing at home, but you know. We're running a little short on time, I wonder. Maybe I can show a little bit of this. This is a process video for one of these. So you can see a little bit of the etching process that goes on there. So this device is a device that lets you listen to electromagnetic fields. So it like picks up electromagnetic fields around electronic objects, converts them into audio. So I was thinking, during lockdown, I was thinking about exploring, what kind of explorations could I do around my home? Everything seemed so familiar, so I really got into this, like listening to this like alternate dimension of sound that was present around me and that I didn't know of. Cool. This is an installation from 2018. These are, let's see if this works. Maybe not. This is an installation thinking about death and people who have died at the hands of the state, of the Argentinian state, one way or the other. And this was like a collection of the people that have died during my lifetime that I remember. And I was like trying to make an exercise in holding on to their memory. And like this piece is an exercise in collective memory, and like trying to think about how memory works through communities and how to keep the, yeah, these people's memory alive. So these are like these little, I can have a pointer here, right? Yes, cool. These are like postcards that are painted with glow-in-the-dark paint, so phosphorescent paint, and there was a projection on them that's this projection that you can see here that's kind of like digital noise, right? You can't really make out what it is. But over time, you can't really see them here, but you look in the next slide. Whoops, it created these images. So each postcard has the face of a person that's dead, right? And you could take these postcards with you, and they're really fragile because the only thing that's holding that face there is the light that's been, the light that has hit the surface. If you expose it to the sun, it just goes completely blank. So you had to take them and like be careful with them. It's like an exercise in taking care of this memory. So this was a process of printing through light, really, right? There's a substrate that's this glow-in-the-dark paint, but the thing that's actually creating the image is this projected light, right? I think I'll skip this because we don't really have time. So we'll think about, talk a little bit about what we'll be learning in the class. Let me get my mouse. Cool. So some of the basic things we'll talk about are image composition. What are some guidelines that can help us create and design images in a way that they tell the story or convey the message that we want? So we'll talk about like perspective and grids and the way that our eyes move across an image. The image is the blueprint for an installation by Doug Wheeler that I really like. We can talk about that later. We'll also learn a little bit about color. How does color work in a digital environment? How does color work in an analog environment? What are the different ways of thinking about color digitally? And what are some really basic color guidelines that can also help us? How can we mix colors in a way that is harmonious or at least useful for what we want to do, right? This is the color wheel that we had at the printmaking shop to mix inks. It was great. My coworker called it the Oracle. We'll also talk a little bit about the digital image. What is a digital image? How is a digital image stored? What are different ways of representing digital images? So what is a bitmap or a raster image? What is a vector image? What do we use them for, and what are their differences? I would like us to have, even if it's a basic understanding, I would like us to have a solid understanding of this, because this is important and it's really useful. And we'll also talk a little bit about what are the different modes of displaying an image, right? So if I have an image that's digital, how can I turn it physical, right? Through displays or projectors or through printing. We'll talk a little bit about typography. This is a topic that actually Philip will present. So we'll talk about typefaces and typeface families and how typography is important to communication and how it affects it. This is a topic that actually I think Philip is much better equipped than I am to explain, so we'll have his expertise, which is great. We'll also introduce information design, so we'll talk a little bit about data visualizations and infographics and what they are and why we would use them, And what is the advantage of processing information through a graphic medium? What is the advantage of visual data? What does it allow us to do that numerical data doesn't? Let's try to go over the projects. What things will we be making? So the first thing we'll make is a collage. We'll make a physical analog collage out of magazines. And then we'll scan it and we'll modify it digitally in Photoshop. So we'll try to understand the differences between working in an analog workspace and a digital workspace, and how can we combine them, and what possibilities do each provide us with. This is an image by Gret Stern, who was a German-Argentinian photographer, and just like a really avant-garde feminist photographer in Argentina in the 50s, who made these collages of women's dreams for a magazine. And I can show you more later, they're really incredible. We'll also make an infographic or a small data visualization. So we'll talk a little bit about data collection and ways of representing data graphically. And we'll also talk about how data collection can really become a practice. And we'll look at some artists who work with data either that is acquired, so data that they get from somewhere, or data that they record themselves. This image is by Tiga Brain and Sam Levine. This is a project that takes all of the blueprints of all of the apartments that are for sale in New York City and combines them into like a single super massive apartment. So it's somewhere between a data visualization and a digital sculpture project. And it's fascinating and terrifying at the same time. And the last thing we'll do is we'll try to make a small zine. We'll make a zine to reflect on the time that you've spent here, and we'll try to include things that you have done in this class, but we'll also try to include things from other classes, so maybe highlights from any of the other classes that you liked. The image on the right is by Secret Rhizo Club, which is a collective in New York that make rhizo prints and zines. And they're really good. I think this one is a zine that was all like a list of excuses to not go to work, which I really like. So let's, how much we have some time. Let's take a look at some artists. So some artists that I think are relevant when thinking about prints. This is Artemio Rodriguez. He's a Mexican printmaker, works with traditional media. He does wood carvings and then prints them. So print has a really prolific history, right? We could go back to like the first letterpress and to first Bibles being printed and the first means of mechanical reproduction, right? I find, you know, I'm from Latin America, so I always try to avoid Eurocentric ways of thinking, and I try to think in a Latin American way. I, of course, due to colonization, I always catch myself having Eurocentric thoughts, but I try to eliminate them. Mexico has a really fascinating history of print that we can talk about. They have a really, really, really strong heritage of print and of print as a political medium. Artemio is a contemporary artist, but who works in a really traditional manner, and he produces these like highly detailed and highly symbolic prints that are very beautiful. This, as you can imagine, is a person attempting to cross the border into the US, right? And the sun that is killing him is this representation of Uncle Sam. This is another Mexican artist, Betsabe Romero. She works with print, and she's famous for making these tires, these car tires that are engraved and are later used as stamps to print. So she engraves these tires with a hot knife, inks them, and then rolls them through spaces or onto surfaces and creates these prints. And there are many things here that we could discuss. You know, she's working, she's recycling these like industrial, highly toxic material that otherwise turns into pollution. She does this in a collaborative way. She doesn't cut and engrave them herself. She runs like workshops and classes and events with community in which people do these. They bring their own tires, they engrave their own tires, and then they print their own stuff, or they just run it through space. She's great, she's excellent. This is also a commentary on, you know, Mexico City in particular has such a density of cars and such a density of pollution, right? So this is really the most readily available material that there is. Jenny Holzer, who works with text, will talk a little bit more about this kind of work, maybe when we hear Philip's presentation. I think, you know, her work is always publicly situated, and it is placed in just everyday environments, and I think it forces you to take a step back from, you know, everyday life and just think a little bit. Barbara Kruger, who I'm sure you're all familiar with, she works primarily with text and type as well. She's used, I think, mostly the same typeface for her entire career. She has a show at LACMA right now, which I recommend seeing. She makes these very loud graphics that are, you know, very confronting, right? And she also makes this kind of work, this kind of installation work, where she turns an entire room into a piece of graphical type. So, you know, we're very used to seeing type and graphical pieces as rectangles, maybe on a magazine or on a computer screen or on a poster, something that, you know, you can, that is smaller than you, that you can read in its entirety. In this case, it turns into space, and it really engages your body. If you stand there, you find yourself kind of like craning your neck to be able to read. It makes you process the work with your body in a very different way than if you were just reading it on a screen like we are now, unfortunately. This is a local artist, Kim Aveles, I guess. She prints things with smog. So she makes these stencils and puts them on top of a piece of paper and just leaves it like on the roof of her house for an amount of time. And the smog in the air deposits and prints, and it's concerning and disgusting. And it's interesting because, again, it's taking what's available here, you know, the locally available material that is also very problematic, and using it in this process. I think the one on the left is the first one that she did about 30 years ago, and the one on the right is a more recent one. This is a project that we'll talk a lot about. This is Dear Data. This is a data visualization project done, and it's also a postal art project done by two graphic designers who got to know each other through a year-long project of sending each other postcards once a week with data collections from their own lives. So they would do like all the times they said no in a week and make a little visual piece about that, all the times they kissed the person in a week, and so on for a year, and developed a really like tight and deep friendship. And the entire process is like, very compelling and beautiful, and we'll talk a lot about this project. The last one that I have for you is Scottish artist Natalie Miebach, who makes these really complex data sculptures. This is a visualization of a hurricane. I don't remember which one, because she's done a lot of them. But all the elements that are here represent some kind of atmospheric phenomena. So if you had the way to read it, you would understand when there was a lot of rain, when there was a lot of wind, and so on. And she works in this way where she collects data herself. She has like these homemade weather stations that she puts in places, and she then turns that into sculpture. And she even has these projects in which those sculptures are like played as music scores by musicians. So she has people turn all this data into music. And it's a super interesting process, and we'll talk more about it later and see more examples. So this is all I have for you. Thank you so much. I'm really looking forward to getting to know all of you and working with Philip and you during these 2 weeks. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you for your presentation. So it's lunchtime. We're actually a little early. So I'm going to ask that you come back by 1:30. We will meet out on the lawns in your group, and then we'll go into our group breakout sessions. Make sure you don't go too far for lunch. And then last thing is you can pick up one t-shirt on the way out. There's a t-shirt on the table, and our staff can pick a t-shirt too.